Hello and welcome to Laranara. In this video, we're going to talk about another very important organ in our organism that is not often talked about for some reason, and that is the spleen. And as you're gonna see, the spleen fulfills a lot of vital functions in our organism, and therefore it is crucial to keep it in a healthy, well-functioning state. And as always with our videos, we're gonna give you some tips on the foods that are beneficial for the spleen and some natural supplements, of course. But before we do all that, I would just like to remind you that we still have the greatest sales action of the whole year going on at laranara.com. Until the end of the year only, you can get some of the most powerful holistic health devices at incredible prices. So take advantage of that. And now, without any further ado, let's learn more about the functions of the spleen and how to keep it naturally healthy. Let's then talk about the spleen. Western medicine considers the spleen to be an organ of the lymphatic system. It is located in the left side of the abdominal cavity under your diaphragm and the muscular portion between the abdomen and the chest. In us humans, it is about the size of a fist and is well supplied with blood. And as the lymph nodes are filters for the lymphatic fluid, the spleen is the primary filtering element for the blood. The spleen also plays an important role in storing and releasing certain types of immune cells that mediate tissue inflammation. And the spleen is encased in a thick connective tissue capsule. And inside, the mass of splenic tissue is of two types, the red pulp and the white pulp, which do not separate into regions but intermingle and are distributed throughout the spleen. The white pulp is lymphoid tissue that usually surrounds splenic blood vessels. And the red pulp is a network of splenic cords, also known as cords of Billroth, and sinusoids, which are white vessels that are filled with blood. And it is in the red pulp that most of the filtration occurs. The white pulp of the spleen contains typical lymphoid elements such as plasma cells, lymphocytes, and lymphatic nodules that are called follicles. Germinal centers in the white pulp serve as the sites of lymphocyte production, and similar to the lymph nodes, the spleen reacts to microorganisms and other antigens that reach the bloodstream by releasing special phagocytic cells known as macrophages. Splenic macrophages reside in both red and white pulp, and they serve to remove foreign material from the blood and to initiate an immune reaction that results in the production of antibodies. The red pulp has a specialized role in addition to filtration. It is the body's major site of destruction of red blood cells, which normally have a lifespan of only 120 days. Those degenerated red blood cells are removed from the circulation in the spleen, and the hemoglobin that they contain is degraded to a readily excretable pigment and an iron molecule that is recycled, i.e. used to produce new hemoglobin elsewhere. In some species, the spleen also acts as a reservoir for blood during periods of inactivity, and when such an animal is aroused for defense or flight, the capsule of the spleen contracts, forcing additional blood reserves into the circulation. It is unclear whether we humans and our spleen has this same capabilities. And the spleen works together with the stomach and the pancreas to digest and transport nutrients that are extracted from food. Spleen also controls the blood and the blood circulation, meaning that old red blood cells are recycled in the spleen, as we've discussed already shortly, and platelets and white blood cells are stored in the spleen. The spleen also controls the muscles and the limbs, meaning that the spleen will save any useful components from the old blood cells, including the iron, to be reused in new cells. And the spleen can increase the size in order to store blood. The organ can widen or shrink depending on the body's needs, and at its largest, the spleen can hold up to a cup of spared blood. The spleen also extracts and distributes excessive water. Dirty water is transported to the kidneys for filtration, and the clear water is sent to the lungs to be converted into qi energy. The spleen also controls the rising energy to the lungs, heart, and also exchanges fluids with the kidneys, and is an important part of our immune system. If the spleen detects potentially dangerous bacteria, viruses, or other microorganisms in the blood, it creates white blood cells called lymphocytes, which act as defenders. And the spleen helps fight certain kinds of bacteria that cause pneumonia and meningitis. The major role of the spleen is to transform food into nutrients, blood, and energy, and distribute them to other organs and tissues. And this enormously difficult task takes a lot of energy on its own. And therefore, if one is overworked and/or malnourished, the spleen will become deficient and unable to manufacture enough blood and energy. And if this becomes continuous and chronic, one may become not only energy deficient, but also blood deficient. A healthy spleen will give a clear, distinctive taste in the mouth, while a deficient spleen will manifest in a sticky taste if there is dampness, and a sweet taste if there is heat in the spleen. The spleen also governs our thoughts, because brain activities depend normally on furnishing the nutrients, qi energy and blood, as well as the yin and the yang. And with adequate qi and blood and a normal function of the spleen stomach, brain activities can proceed normally. Any mental process such as thinking, concentrating, studying and focusing are also governed by the spleen. Therefore, people with healthy spleens are generally active, practical, and responsible. They study well and memorize efficiently. And people with unhealthy spleens tend to have a busy mind, to overthink, and manifest a stuck behavior. When there is accumulated dampness in the spleen, the thoughts take the quality of the dampness and become also sticky and oppressive. An enlarged spleen can be caused by infections, liver diseases, blood diseases characterized by abnormal blood cells, problems with the lymphatic system, or other conditions such as infections, especially viral infections such as mononucleosis, parasitic infections such as toxoplasmosis, malaria, bacterial infections such as endocarditis, which is an infection of your heart's valves, spirochetes infections such as syphilis and Lyme borreliosis. Other condition is also cancer such as cirrhosis, leukemia, lymphomas, Hodgkin's disease and myeloproliferative neoplasms. Also inflammatory diseases such as sarcoidosis, lupus and rheumatoid arthritis. Trauma such as an injury during contact sports. A cyst, the non-cancerous fluid-filled sac, that is a large abscess, which is a pus-filled cavity usually caused by a bacterial infection, but also infiltrative diseases such as Gaucher's disease, Niemann-Pick disease, amyloidosis, or glycogen storage diseases. An enlarged spleen affects each of these vital functions, and as your spleen grows larger, it filters normal red blood cells as well as abnormal ones, reducing thereby the number of healthy cells in your bloodstream. It also traps then too many platelets. Excess red blood cells and platelets eventually can clog up your spleen and affect normal functioning. An enlarged spleen may even outgrow its own blood supply, which can then damage and destroy sections of the organ. Potential complications of an enlarged spleen are that an enlarged spleen can reduce the number of healthy red blood cells and platelets as well as white cells in your bloodstream, which leads to more frequent infections. Anemia and increased bleeding is also possible. Then we have a ruptured spleen. Even healthy spleens are very soft and can therefore be easily damaged, especially in car crashes. And the possibility of rupture is much greater when your spleen is enlarged. A ruptured spleen can cause life-threatening bleeding into your abdominal cavity. The spleen originates from the new mesoderm and is therefore controlled from the cerebral medulla, and the brain relay is located exactly in the area where the spleen has its place as a lymphatic node, and there is a crossover correlation from the brain to the organ. The psychogenic conflict linked with the spleen pathologies is a so-called bleeding or injury conflict, which is a self-devaluation conflict associated with blood. In nature, the inability to fight because of a large bleeding wound quickly leads to death, and such a psychogenic trigger is caused by bleeding due to an injury, a hemorrhage, heavy periods, but also when there is blood in the stool, in the urine, in the vaginal discharge, which of course can often cause great panic. A blood cancer, leukemia diagnosis, or a positive HIV test, where the fear of being HIV positive is really great, being on dialysis, blood transfusions, or distressing blood test results could also evoke this type of bleeding conflict that affects the spleen. What are the causes of spleen energy deficiency then? Well, an exhaustion of the spleen energy can be caused by an overconsumption of cold and raw foods, excessive eating of large amounts of food, excessive consumption of proteins, late night eating, and the spleen has of course the difficult and very complicated task to transform the food that we eat and the fluids that we drink into nutrients, blood and energy as we've already discussed, and also transport them to all of the organs and body tissues that need them. And this of course requires a lot of energy on its own to take place, and to get this energy the spleen needs to work in a warm and dry environment, as cold temperature and damp environments have the nature of slowing things down and making processes sluggish. Thus it is contraindicated to consume cold and raw foods, which are cold in nature, slowing down the complicated work of the spleen thereby. Regular consumption of ice cream, ice drinks, and generally foods straight out of the refrigerator, as well as raw fruits and vegetables, are also a major cause for the spleen to become weak and underfunctioning. Also, excessive eating of large amounts of food is another major cause for the spleen to become deficient. The food that we eat takes a lot of time to be processed, therefore eating lots of food at a time overloads the spleen. Irregular eating will also eventually wear down the spleen. Also, eating too much proteins, especially meat, is heavy on the spleen. The meat is the food that stays the longest in our stomach and takes the longest time to digest and be absorbed. Therefore, regular overeating and overconsumption of proteins wears down the spleen. The other extreme also leads to spleen deficiency, meaning eating too little or eating a protein deficient diet does not provide enough energy for the spleen to function and support itself. So you must find a good middle ground there. Let's go over the most common symptoms of an exhausted spleen next. First up is poor appetite, then feeling tired after eating. Fatigue and sleepiness after meals indicate a deficient spleen, or can indicate a deficiency in your spleen functioning. General tiredness, if the spleen is unable to perform its transformational duties, or to transform the food into blood and energy as discussed, this leads to a general energy deficiency and lassitude. And the muscles and body tissues are not being sufficiently nourished, and therefore weakness of the limbs may be experienced as well. As there is not enough blood produced, the facial complexion may also become shallow and the tongue is pale. Weakness of the limbs is another common symptom, especially the legs. Gas and bloating in the abdomen with abdominal distension. Loose stools, because if the spleen energy is deficient for longer periods of times, digestive troubles may appear. Symptoms like watery stools rather than loose stools, which often contain undigested food, will also appear soon, and there will be also cold signs in addition to the digestive symptoms, such as coldness in the abdomen, cold hands, feet, a swollen and wet tongue with teeth marks on the sides, etc. Also, watery stools with undigested food, a prolonged spleen energy deficiency may also lead to a prolapse of the stomach, the uterus, and the anus. And urgent as well as frequent urination is another sign, a possible sign of spleen weakness. One of the functions of the spleen is to hold the blood in the vessels, and thus a deficient spleen may sometimes manifest in bleeding, such as blood in the stool and or urine, bleeding from the uterus, and blood spots under the skin, and purpura. Okay, now that we've gained a better understanding of the functions of the spleen, how important it is for our overall health, and the symptoms we need to look out for in order to detect a malfunctioning spleen, let's discuss natural treatments of an exhausted spleen, including nutrition and other lifestyle choices that you should make. So the strategy for treating an exhausted spleen is to fuel the spleen with energy. Adding warm or mildly sweet foods to the diet is the way to do that, as warm temperature and sweet taste promote energy. Mildly sweet foods are carbohydrate-rich vegetables such as carrots, winter squash, pumpkins, yams, peas, sweet potato, parsnip, and turnip. Oats, spelt, and especially well-cooked rice are also wonderful sweet and pungent spleen tonics. Small amounts of dates and red cherries have a great tonifying effect on the spleen. And also, as an additional effect, both fruits also build blood, which assists in the overall body nourishment, as the weak spleen cannot produce enough blood. Warm foods are vegetables such as onions, garlic, and leeks, as well as pungent spices such as black pepper, fennel, cinnamon, and nutmeg. Ginger is a great herb to tonify the spleen with. It can be added to the meal or you can drink it as a tea. And if your digestion is poor, the above listed foods can still be used, but there should be an emphasis now on the warm foods rather than the mildly sweet ones. Such foods are garlic and all members of the onion family. By the way, never onions on empty stomach or and preferably cooked in order not to irritate your stomach. Also great are well-crushed walnuts, black pepper, curry, and other hot spices. You can also substitute the raw ginger with dry ginger, which is warmer in nature. And also it is important to reduce the intake of meats or to consume only small amounts of well-cooked meat. Chicken is warm in nature as a food and is easy to digest. Therefore, a well-cooked soft chicken will not weigh down the spleen's work and is recommended. Fish is another good source of protein, which is not heavy on the spleen. Again, you should consume the fish well cooked. It is also always good to add some well-cooked rice to each meal in order to soften the food and make it easier to digest. And it is imperative also to avoid cold and raw foods as well as drinks, as they will furthermore extinguish the digestive fire. Also, because the spleen governs the muscles, one way to tonify the spleen is to exercise. It is essential though not to overdo it, therefore mild exercises such as walking in a park or some mild yoga for beginners is a good start. When you feel more energized, you can start doing more demanding exercises, of course, for longer periods of time. People who exercise frequently, by the way, always have much stronger spleen and a better digestion. On a vital level, the way to tonify the spleen is to moxa four stomach points called the four doors. These points are the stomach 25 point, the RAN 6 and RAN 12. And the stomach 36 is a great tonifying point for any spleen deficiency symptoms. Spleen 6 tonifies the spleen qi, and stomach 21 is used for stomach prolapses. On a mental level, the spleen will majorly benefit from counteracting excessive thinking and excessive mental work, including too much studying or any type of work. Worry is another emotion which impairs the spleen. Therefore, creating a habit To take frequent mental breaks from work, school, and thoughts is a good start. We can try, for example, to go to a place in our mind that is peaceful and quiet, where problems look like funny, ridiculous creatures or simply do not exist. And we can also imagine, for example, laying down on or running on an endless field, ripe with fertility and potential, because the spleen belongs to the element of earth. And there we can, of course, experience the sensation of being free and liberated from anything that preoccupies our minds. We can feel then the energy coming from this earth and use it to transform any worrying thoughts into strength, activity, and confidence. And you can perform this type of exercises several times per day. Also helpful is deep breathing. You can also exercise this very easily, and you can deepen your concentration by doing these breathing exercises. They are really simple. You inhale slowly for 4 seconds and exhale slowly for another 4 seconds. There are also some great herbs to treat an energy deficient spleen. In traditional Chinese medicine, the spleen is referred to as the collective work of some organs, including the pancreas and the stomach, and systems, including the liver, the gallbladder, and the small intestine, that participate in the digestion rather than the anatomical organ spleen. And when one of these major organs is energy deficient, all other organs are also impacted with the qi deficiency and their symptoms. And therefore, the spleen energy deficiency must be treated together with the problems with the stomach, the lungs, the kidneys, and the heart deficiencies. Spleen qi deficiency symptoms are poor energy, a lack of appetite, feeling tired after meals, gas and bloating, a loose stool, or diarrhea. Lung qi deficiency symptoms are shortness of breath, dislike to speak, overall weak immunity, and coughing. A heart qi deficiency manifests itself with heart palpitations, spontaneous sweating, emotional disharmony, and poor quality sleep. When a kidney qi deficiency manifests itself with frequent urination, dribbling after urination, urinating at night, incontinence, and aneurysis. Radix ginseng is a well-known herb throughout the world, and it has strong tonifying properties, and warm nature ginseng strongly boosts up the energy, working especially well for the spleen qi and the lung qi deficiency patterns. It benefits lethargy, a lack of appetite, and chronic diarrhea caused by spleen qi deficiency and wheezing, shortness of breath, and labored breathing caused by lung qi deficiency. It also profits the heart qi deficiency, benefiting symptoms such as anxiety, insomnia, forgetfulness, and accompanied with heart palpitations also. So radix ginseng highly recommended, as well as Codonopsis pilosula for cooler nature. Also Pseudostellaria heterophylla. It's an even gray, gentler root translated as child root that also tonifies the qi. Also great is Dioscorera opposita, which is Chinese yam. It's widely used not only in Chinese medicine, but also Chinese everyday cooking. And when peeled, cut, and boiled, the root tastes very similar to our potatoes. Its neutral temperature makes it appropriate for both hot and cold conditions of the spleen. Then we have Astragalus membranaceus. It's a key tonifying herb that strengthens the immunity and is used for frequent colds. It boosts up the lung and addresses shortness of breath also. It tonifies the spleen, benefiting spleen qi deficiency symptoms such as poor appetite, fatigue, and diarrhea. And what makes Huang Qi distinctive is its quality to raise the qi of the spleen and stomach, and therefore it is widely used for also prolapse of the uterus, the stomach or rectum, as well as for uterine bleeding due to the deficiencies. Then we have Atractylodes marcocephala. It is an herb that both tonifies the spleen qi and also drains internal dampness manifesting in water accumulations and edemas. And this herb also has the property to calm restless fetuses. We also have Sisyphus jujuba, that is the well big date. It tonifies both qi and blood and has a calming effect. It is used for irritability or emotional disharmony, and this herb, together with another qi tonifying herb called Glycyrrhiza uralensis or licorice, is commonly added to other herbal formulas because of their quality to moderate and harmonize the characteristics of the other herbs. Licorice root enters all 12 channels, and besides moderating the harsh quality of other herbs, it's also an antidote for a variety of toxic substances. It tonifies the qi and moistens the lungs, addressing dry coughing as well as wheezing also. Then we have Polygonatum sibiricum or Siberian Solomon seal. This also tonifies the spleen qi and moistens the lungs, but also tonifies the kidney essence, addressing kidney essence deficiency symptoms such as weakness in the limbs and lower back as well as lightheadedness. Also great is barley malt sugar, because this also of course tonifies the spleen qi and also moistens the lungs. The other condition that the spleen can suffer from is spleen dampness according to TCM. Dampness is heavy and turbid in nature, and thus the symptoms of internal dampness manifest in feeling heaviness in the body, a cloudy head, or having a cloudy urine. Since dampness is equal to water retention, one of the symptoms of dampness is edemas and swelling. Other symptoms include bloated abdomen, loose stools, and a lack of appetite. And there are two types of internal dampness, a cold dampness and damp heat. Cold damp symptoms include all the symptoms of internal dampness together with oppression in the chest and epigastrium and of feeling of cold in the epigastrium. The nature of dampness is heaviness, thus dampness has the tendency to sink downward, manifesting in the wide vaginal discharge in women, for example. As dampness is water retention, the body has no need for more fluids, thus there is no sensation of thirst also. When it comes to damp heat symptoms, they include all the symptoms of internal dampness together with stiffness or pain in the epigastrium and lower abdomen. Also loose stool with an offensive odor. When there is heat, there is odor and a scanty dark yellow urination. As heat manifests in thirst, but with dampness there is no thirst, and an interesting typical sign of this damp heat is thirst with no desire to drink. And some nausea and vomiting may also be present. General spleen dampness symptoms are a feeling of heaviness in the body, a cloudy head, cloudy urine, edema or swelling, bloated abdomen, loose stools, a lack of appetite, numbness in the limbs, bacterial and yeast overgrowth, as well as a greasy tongue coating. And besides having a heavy and turbid nature, dampness is also obstructive. Thus, dampness blocks the free flow of blood, energy, and also invades the joints. Movement becomes difficult and numbness in the limbs is experienced and the pain is fixed in location. The condition worsens, of course, in damp environments or in cloudy and rainy days. Just like bacteria and parasites thrive in an external damp environment, so do they do in an internal damp body environment. And therefore, chronic internal dampness may lead to bacteria and parasite overgrowth and is the fittest environment or the best environment for yeasts, also viruses, bacteria and cancer cells. So internal dampness is also on top of that more difficult to clear because of its heavy nature, and it takes longer time to cure. Internal dampness originates from a deficient spleen, and therefore changing the diet is also essential for treating this type of spleen dampness. But that's not all that you can do. Foods also can contribute to the accumulation of dampness And here, all cold and mucus-forming foods, you should pay attention to them. They should be avoided until the dampness is cleared. Such foods are all raw foods, which are cold in nature, but also eggs, milk and dairy products, which are mucus-producing in general, as well as sweet foods. So we discussed that a sweet taste tonifies the spleen, but taken excessively, it has the opposite effect. Fats, oil, butter, nuts and seeds and all fried foods should also be avoided. You should consume meat moderately in small quantities and cook it well. And the meals should be simple with not too many spices or ingredients. You should also avoid overeating and late night eating. Foods that particularly dry dampness are bitter foods, such as lettuce, also celery, alfalfa, rye, and the herbs chaparral or Laurea divaricata and chamomile. Aduki beans are also a great food for clearing internal dampness because of their intensely drying nature. Also slightly sweet yellow foods such as corn, pumpkins and raw honey dry dampness and tonify the spleen's energy. In the cases of cold damp, pungent foods may be added as they have warming and drying properties. Such foods are scallion, mustard greens, onions and white pepper. In the case of damp heat, the above pungent foods, the above mentioned pungent foods should be avoided. However, instead you should supplement with the wild blue-green algae, also known as Alpha Nisomenon. With its bitter cooling and mildly diuretic drying property, this wild blue-green algae clears heat and dries dampness simultaneously. It's also a neurostimulator and an antidepressant and a relaxant, therefore it's also a great treatment for depressive conditions due to stagnation. And believe it or not, oxygen is another antidote to dampness. Because a damp internal environment is an environment, thus promoting a bigger flow of oxygen in the body will naturally help to clear dampness. And one way of achieving this is exercise. Another way is by performing deep breathing exercises such as inhaling slowly for 4 seconds and exhaling slowly for 20 to 40 seconds. On a vital level, dampness can be cleared by using the acupuncture or acupressure points stomach 40 and spleen 9, stomach 36 and Ren 12. They also tonify the spleen and resolve dampness. And in cases of cold, damp moxa can also be applied on the above points. Painful, heavy or numb joints may also benefit from this moxa approach. And in cases of damp heat, moxa should not be used. Instead, the points large intestine 11 and gallbladder 34 may be added to clear heat. And when it comes to the mental level, internal dampness manifests in unclear thinking and sticky thoughts. And to help clear dampness from the mind, we may visualize a pleasant, fresh and abundant wind going through our mind and body, blowing the dampness away from our organs, head and thoughts. We can imagine the wind circulating throughout the body, clearing everything that is heavy, sticky and turbid, and experience becoming lighter and the thoughts becoming clearer, sharper and more incisive. And we can remain in this stage as long as we wish and add the above mentioned deep breathing exercises for. We can also treat this spleen dampness with herbs. A mineral used in the treatment of dampness is talcum. It is known in TCM as huashi or slippery rock, which absorbs dampness topically and is used for damp skin lesions as well. Then we have Croix lacrima jovi and Benin Saka hispida. They promote urination and stop diarrhea. They increase joint mobility and also help with the lungs or intestinal abscesses, and are also great for treating plantar warts. Winter melon seeds promote the discharge of pus and are also beneficial for damp heat vaginal discharge with thick and unpleasant odors. Next we have Polyporus umbellatus, which is a mushroom that enters the spleen, the kidney, the urinary bladder channels and also treats edemas, urinary dysfunction, jaundice and diarrhea. Also great is China root or Poria cocos. It's very famous in Chinese medicine. It's a diuretic that besides leaching out dampness, is also a spleen tonic which benefits with digestion. Another major action is to calm the spirit through strengthening the heart, and it is also used for symptoms such as heart palpitations, insomnia and mental restlessness. Artemisia capillaris clears the obstruction from the liver and gallbladder and is a main herb in the treatment of jaundice, whether caused by damp heat or a damp cold accumulation. Akebia, trifoliata, tretapanax, papyraceus, and Malva verticillati are good diuretic herbs also that leach out dampness and promote lactation. Then we also have Cochlea scoparia, Polygonum avicularia, and Dioscorea hypoglauca. They are also diuretic herbs that leach out dampness and affect the blood. They break also blood stasis and stop bleeding. Lobelia chinensis cools the blood, also can be used for poisonous snake bites and wasp stings. Then we have Gallium aparin, it promotes urination and removes lymph congestion. It's also beneficial for lymphadenitis. Betula alba promotes urination and drains fluid congestion, also benefits atherosclerosis. And great is also Ribis nigrum, also promotes urination and drains fluid congestion and also benefits the prostate. And with all that, it's time to sum it all up and come to some conclusions. What have we learned? Well, the spleen, by the way, is the organ of late summer and likes the color white-yellow. And I'm sure not many of you were aware of all the important functions that the spleen fulfills in our organism. And therefore also we often say that when you have a spleen, it means you are depressed, pensive, worried and trist. And as we've learned in Western medicine, the spleen is considered to be a lymphatic organ with functions related to the immune lymphatic system and blood filtration, so the quality of your blood. In Eastern medicine, in traditional Chinese medicine, as we've learned, the spleen is an important digestive organ. It is closely related to the pancreas. It tickles the pancreas tail, but also to the stomach, the small intestine, the duodenum, the liver, and the gallbladder. In TCM, as we've seen, for example, the spleen is very important for transforming food into energy, but also the distribution of this energy to the upwards located organs, such as the lungs and the heart. It also takes care of muscle tissue and lymph function, and it governs the thoughts. The spleen, as we've seen, can become exhausted due to so many important tasks, so when you are overworked in any shape, or it can be under dampness attack, as we've seen, which makes all important processes taking place in the spleen sluggish and difficult. The spleen can also become enlarged or it can shrink as a collateral damage in case of cancer, heavy infections, cirrhosis, sarcoidosis, lupus, rheumatoid arthritis, bacterial infections, infiltrative diseases such as Gaucher disease, Niemann-Pick disease, amyloidosis, or glycogen storage diseases. Also, we have learned that in TCM, the spleen and the pancreas are together responsible for many metabolic conditions, and diabetes can be treated by optimizing the spleen-pancreas duo, because the energetic meridian is the spleen-pancreas meridian, so they are connected. We've also presented to you in this video some foods and some other lifestyle advice as well as herbs that support a healthy spleen. The spleen's health, as you've seen, is very much dependent on your general lifestyle, so your eating habits. Don't eat excessively, don't drink too much alcohol. It also depends on the consumption of cold food, or not overeating meat, or better not eating meat at all. Also eating too sweet, being overworked, burnt out, worried too much. All of these factors can sicken the spleen. Therefore, moderate eating, no alcohol, light sweet vegetables and fruits that we've discussed, little white meat, good sleep, exercising, active and self-confident mindset, they're all prerogatives to maintaining a healthy spleen and thus a well-functioning body. If you have any questions or you need personal advice and consultation on what is best for you, please do not hesitate to contact us 1-888-773-3196. That is 1-888-773-3196. We love to advise you on what is best for you. And also, do not forget to take advantage of our biggest sales action of the year 2019. Only valid until the end of the year, so be quick and also as long as supplies last, only some of the most amazing and powerful holistic health devices at unbeatable prices for a limited time only. So be quick, take advantage, don't miss out. If you've enjoyed this presentation, please as always also support our work by liking, sharing and subscribing. Also hit the notifications button, so you don't miss out on the weekly holistic health content that appears on this channel. And with all that being said, stay healthy until next time.